camera on. I just did some pressing and they're dry and I'm putting them away now. I've shown you another video, so I won't go into detail, but I just put these paper sandwiches of flowers or leaves into these books, and then that's how I store them. And then I also put a little sticky note at the edge of each one to tell me what's inside here so that I know. But what I want to show you is what they look like after they're pressed. So this is going to be in the peeking with videos department. The first one here is, I'm working around the camera. This is a fiddle fern, and I brought in one to show you what they look like before they're pressed. So this is before and after. And then the Euphorbia, which is this guy. And this is what it looks like before it's pressed. They're kind of weird, twisting. I don't have any Hellebores blooming right now, but this is actually the front. I did pinch the center out, and I didn't save the center, so sometimes I'll find something else to use as a center. And this is the, that's the back, which is also very pretty. I think it's called a rubra or ruby. It's kind of a reddish purple color hellebore. So here's some more. So that's that one. Then this is, let me bring this closer. This is heather. And what I call red azalea. And this, I did bring some in. This is what it looks like before it's pressed. And then I take the individual florets off and then press the leaves, because this center here is actually really thick. And so to get these to lay as flat as they are, you really need to take the individual flowers off. And so these are azaleas. Azaleas are blooming now in a lot of locations. And you can see as a general rule with reds and pinks, oftentimes they will go darker. But I really, they hold, these particular variety holds their color well and makes it through the press really, really easily. So try it. Some don't press as good as others, but I know that this one does. What else is here? Oh, these are the heather florets, which you've probably seen in some of my other videos. They're really good for miniature work. I just strip them off of the they're on a little cluster, and I just strip them off. So that's how that goes. Let's see. Then we have, this is Haps Rhodes. This is from a rhododendrons. This is the first one of the season, and it's really beautiful in the garden. But they don't press. I just can't explain it. You can't just press the whole flower like you do with the azalea that I just showed you. So I just press it in half and make like a fan, and then use it as a background for other things. And so I think those are really pretty. And here's some more azaleas. This is the spring flower and anemone from a quorum. And I did break them down. Now this one I did press whole. But for the most part, there's another kind that has different kind of petals, and I dismantled them. And so this had had the anemone on top. This is the center. And let me get some of the petals. And then I don't typically, if I dismantle them, unless it's something really special. But here's the petals. So for example, you'd take, you can already figure this out, but I'll just pretend and demonstrate here. Take the petals and arrange them back into a circle, and then take your center and then put your center back in. But there's no way that these petals would have pressed as flat as they did without dismantling them and pressing them separate. And so I've got some red anemones and blue anemones out there, and they hold their color well. They're beautiful. Here's a red anemone before it's been dismantled. They're gorgeous. And this is, it's primrose. And I've got a couple different colors out there. Here's one that hasn't been pressed. I think that one is this variety here. And they press really well, kind of sheer. What I really like about the primrose is, look at how beautiful, bring it up closer to the camera. Look at how beautiful that center is. Isn't that gorgeous? That's the front, that's the back. And so in a lot of areas, this would be kind of a shade moisture plant. These are blooming now too. And here's the, from the primrose. And then let's see what else we have here. I'll put the paper back on this one because here's some more. I was going to see if I could find the red ones. Here's some more of the petals for the anemone, and then the leaves that go together with them. And I think the next one must be the red. Yeah, here's some red anemone. See how beautiful those are. And then Pulsitilla. They're kind of different. They've got this really nice center to them, kind of a cottony center. Now, these do oftentimes discolor a little bit in right in the middle, and even when I pinch the centers out after I press them in profile, they still brown. You can see that. This one didn't brown so much. This one made it through pretty good. But since I color enhance these, I don't think it's a problem. It's certainly worth using them, and then I'll color enhance that so you won't really see it so brown. I do have a color enhancement playlist if anyone's interested in that. Just check out my channel. And then this is some more Pulsitilla. Fig buttercup. It's a member of the buttercup. Is it fig? I don't know. It's very evasive, and we actually have a clump around here, so why not use them if they're gonna be evasive around here? But that's what those are. And here's another one. They're really pretty. I just wish they weren't invasive, but they're gorgeous. Look at how pretty those are. And they hold their color for, you know, fairly well. When they start turning, similar to buttercup, they'll kind of turn more of a creamy yellow. But they still look good. These leaves hold their color for a really long time. Generally speaking, people ask, well, how long do things hold their color? I pretty much don't, for the most part, press anything anymore unless I know that they're going to hold their color really well, or I know I'm able to color enhance them. If something is going to fade super quick, then I don't even bother. So anything I show you for the most part is worth the effort. These are those English daisies that are, they're like weeds in yards around our neighborhood. And then we also have a park down at the end of the street where they're all in the grass there, which is where I got these. But they're beautiful little items to use in your work. So this whole series here is daisies, daisies, daisies. That's all. That's really all these were really early season, and so there was only so much to pick from. And then I did a few leaves, which I will show you really quickly if you want to stick around for that. Some more of these fiddle ferns. You got to get fiddle ferns quick because they're not there very long before they're just too big and they're not fiddly anymore. This is a different kind of fern. And typically, the fiddle ferns always kind of turn brown. I do try to tint them or color enhance them a little bit. With all of this furry stuff, though, it's a little bit of a challenge. But that's what it looks like in the garden. What that is. No, that's just a piece of leaf of something else. Okay. But they're really interesting looking, and I like them a lot, so they're worth it taking the time to press them. Pieris is, that's a leaf off of a pieris bush, and again, they turn dark. Here's what they look like before they're pressed. But in the spring, these leaves, the new growth turns this really beautiful. It's called, I think it's a fire mountain or fire something pieris. And they're really pretty. But I just like the way that they press them and the shape of them. And when I color enhance them, I will use something over the top. I will use a tint that's a little bit more of a reddish color. So they'll still look a little rusty, but they'll be a little bit more reddish, a little bit hopefully closer to how they look here. But for backgrounds and where you want a little bit of interest, those are kind of different if you have anything like that in your area. Here's some, excuse me, my voice, here's some more pieris. Queen Anne's lace leaf, which I love, and they hold their color really well. They're good for both bigger arrangements, as you can see here. And you can break them down into small little bits, so they're good for small arrangements. And here is, I think that's from a fennel. And I brought both of them in. Here's Queen Anne's before it's pressed. Getting kind of wilty. It's been sitting in my box for a while I was fiddling about getting this video ready to film. And then here is fennel, which is absolutely gorgeous. And I think dill is pretty similar in its leaf structure. So if you don't have fennel but you grow dill in your garden for culinary purposes, you might want to give that a try. And again, you can do a whole larger arrangement, or you can do little tiny segments and for smaller detail work. This is monk's hood. This is off of monk's hood, which is this guy before it's pressed. And so that's what that looks like. It doesn't change too much on pressing. Some more Queen Anne and fennel. More Queen Anne here. And then this is Pulsitilla. I already showed you the flowers and then that butter cup thing, member family that I showed you. Here's the leaves. And here's some Pulsitilla leaves, which, again, you can use them larger or break them down into small little segments. And then something else, which I think turns out, excuse me again for bumping the camera, it turns out interesting, is lupin leaves. And here is one from the garden. It's really gotten limp waiting for its day on the camera, but anyway, there. And I like them when they're just kind of starting to come out before they've been around for a while, because when they've been around for a while, then they get a bunch of blemishes and stuff like that. But anyway, this one's so limp. And what's really interesting that I like a lot is when you press them in profile. I just think those turn out really, really cool. So that's lupin. So that's it for this video. It was just a real quick little, I'm putting these away and thought I'd show you what some early season things are that I'm playing around with. So go out, take a look around, and have fun. Thanks for tuning in. You have a wonderful day.